Great. Thank you, Julian, and thank you, ADC, for having me here. It's my first time at ADC, and it's just really exciting to see all the cool audio development happening here. And I want to thank every one of you for being here. It's the last talk of the day, so I really appreciate you being here. I ran product and design at Smule for 7 years, and January this year, I became an advisor, and I'm currently acting as the chief design officer. So here's a brief overview about Smule, which Julian gave you a little bit of a preview. Smule is a social music discovery and collaboration platform. We've seen great growth. In 2016, we grew to 15.2 million monthly active users and doubled our subscriber base. Our users are creating and uploading over 36 terabytes of content every day to our platform using our apps. Sales have grown on average nearly 70% since 2010, and we crossed the 100 million revenue for the first time in 2016. It's certainly harder to have that kind of growth once the numbers get bigger, but we're on track to have 40% growth in 2017, so fingers crossed. So we'll see where that goes. Traffic has grown at least 50% in the past few years, fueled from all over the world, particularly in Southeast Asia. And you can see that North America is now not even our top countries. What's most exciting to me, though, is the amount of music people are engaging with every day. In a single day, people will play, sing, listen to over 20 million songs with each other through their mobile phones and upload over 36 terabytes of music to our network. And let me share a few fun examples of how people are collaborating with each other in Smule. This first one is actually someone who's collaborating. He created collab joining himself several times. The second one is a duet of Despacito. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the song. It's on track to become 2017's top song. And this is between the artist Luis Fonsi himself and a fan joining him from Argentina. This is the full Spanish version before Justin Bieber remixed it and before Justin Bieber's full-on torso tattoo, as far as we know. And
¿Qué pasó, Luis?
Listo.
Sí, señor.
Viene.
Ajá.
Sí, sabes que ya llevo un rato mirándote. Tengo que bailar contigo hoy. Ahora tú.
Ok. Vi que tu mirada ya estabas amándome.
So the singer that joined him is actually in Argentina, and he's our Argentinian singer. And lastly, here's a group performing in full-on makeup and costume and featuring people across US, Canada, and Europe joining each other.
Come with me now. Come with me now. Whoa, come with me now. I'm gonna take you down. Whoa, come with me now. I'm gonna show you how. Whoa, come with me now. I'm gonna take you down. Whoa, come with me now.
So in case you're wondering, no, most of the music created by the community are not this elaborate. In fact, most people are like me. I can't carry in tune after nearly 8 years at Smule. I am still terrified of singing in public. But that's what drew me to Smule. Music is inherently social and much more than listening. It's innate in all of us, yet most people are afraid of making music and don't think they can do it. I know and this fear intimately, and in some ways, driving Smule's mission to connect people all over the world and experience the joy of making music with each other, I think is a way of me being a part of the music. And to be honest, it is a little bit intimidating being here today. And it reminds me a little bit of when I first joined Smule. I was joining a music company with no music background. I couldn't sing, though I didn't realize how out of tune I was until I was in a room with a bunch of computer music geeks with perfect absolute pitch, being the tester for their pitch correction technology. I couldn't play a music instrument. I had aspirations of being a house DJ, but still had no rhythm. And I didn't even know that computer music was a degree at the time, even though this was a company founded by two computer music PhDs. So you might be wondering, why the heck did JB invite me to speak to you today? Well, over the last 8 years, I've been at the front lines of building Smule to the scale it is at now. Through over 10 app launches and multiple updates on iOS and Android, I've worn many hats, even moonlighting as an iOS UI engineer in the first years. Luckily for Smule, the CTO stopped me from checking in code several years ago, and I've been focused on leading product management and design ever since. So I do miss coding quite a bit, but after hearing Julian's talk, I was definitely hacking more code than writing significant code, so it's probably not a great loss for me to stop coding. And as you can imagine, there were quite a few bumps, bruises, and flat-out faceplants along the way as we grew to scale. And what I've learned, besides a whole lot about audio technology and music, is that the key to growth at every stage of your product's maturity is to innovate through focusing on engaging your users and building a lasting relationship with them. The nature of how you connect with your users at each stage will change. So I'm going to share the guiding principles I learned through Smule's growth so far, from building apps to a platform to a community. It's a bit like growing from an infant to toddler to teenager. And you'll see quite a few screens that's a blast from the past, and some original slides never before shown in public outside of Smule. So some of it makes me cringe a little bit to looking back on it now. So this is the first time I've given this talk, so we'll see how it goes. And a quick disclaimer, this talk is sharing the product strategy perspective. And of course, this goes hand in hand with developing and designing audio technology. I won't be able to dive into the learnings from the technical side as much, but I believe the stories and lessons here apply at a broader product level, and hope it will help you think about the growth of your own products and services. Whoops, sorry, forgot the transition there. So in the beginning, it was all about the magic. The iPhone opened a whole new world. No one knew what was possible or how people would even adopt this new mobile device or use it. Remember, Nokias and Blackberries were the leading mobile device back then. And it wasn't just the iPhone itself. It was about how the iPhone empowered people to do what they couldn't do before. So Smule started launching audio apps in 2008 with the goal of opening up the world of possibilities for users to create and experience music making in ways that they weren't used to before. The plan is to experiment quickly, find out what's possible on this device, what sticks, what people like to play with or not, not unlike trying out new toys with new infants. So Ocarina was the first iPhone application that used the friction that your breath makes against a microphone as input for a musical signal. Play. How many of you recognize the song for Legend of Zelda? A friend eagerly showed me this application. It was the first app I saw on the iPhone. And I didn't even own an iPhone at the time, but it made me want to go out, get an iPhone, and play the song. The Ocarina was the first application to become the number one paid app for several weeks. It's crossed every major app store in the world. That set the tone for Smule. And so I got an iPhone, learned iPhone programming, and joined Smule beginning in 2010. We built many apps in the first few years, so I want to talk about three: Magic Piano, Magic Fiddle, and Glee, which I think were exemplary of what we explored and learned in this stage. First, the vision of Magic Piano is reimagine the piano and not show you piano keys. We wanted people to be able to play songs like Moonlight Sonata without having to learn about notes and keys or owning a Steinway. So here's a playoff between Magic Piano and a real baby grand piano. The person playing piano is Jeff, the CEO. I think he practiced more than the person playing the iPad Magic Piano. So one critical design of Magic Piano is to give users an ability for music expression through the control of time. So in Magic Piano, you control the time and can play as fast or as slow as you want, and the notes will follow your speed. This was the magic, because giving users a way to be able to play over and over again, and each time they play, it might be different, but it would still sound good. So Magic Piano opened up an aspect of playing piano to millions of people to this day, and it's super accessible and fun and engaging product, but would you want to listen to songs people play on Magic Piano, and can you tell one person's playing from another's? Maybe not, and was that important? We didn't know yet. So at this time, we debated that guitar would be the obvious next instrument to build after piano, but we wanted to challenge ourselves and our users with something unexpected and unintended on an iPad. Who would have thought you can play the iPad like a fiddle? So here's a video clip of the St. Lawrence String Quartet. They're a world-renowned string quartet from Stanford, playing the magic fiddle. I especially love how they couldn't help themselves moving still when they were playing it. Magic Fiddle was one of the most beautiful apps Smule made. It was fully chromatic and the closest thing to an actual instrument. It turns out that also means it was much less accessible. The retention for this product, measured as a percentage of first-day users returning the next day, was quite poor. Because guess what? It's hard to play the violin. We got really caught up in what we can build with the technology, but in the end, the user simply saw another instrument that was hard to play. And they didn't sound good if it was hard to play, so they didn't come back. So lesson learned here, we need to be inspired by what exists, but focus on building products that enable people to do what they could not before in ways that they did not imagine. So maybe Magic Fiddle wasn't so magical after all. So we talked about instruments, but there's the one instrument that we all have and are born with, our voice. We had this grand vision of 1,000 voices singing together all over the world and seeing them visualized on the globe. So we partnered with Fox Glee to launch Glee Karaoke. The audio magic in Glee helped you get over an intimidation of singing through pitch correction and auto-harmonizing your voice. Glee was the first product as well that allowed you to join anyone in singing with anyone anywhere in the world. You can sound good, and it was fun because it was tied into the TV show at the time. Side story note here, the pitch correction technology. So I was the guinea pig where, as a product manager, I was also not allowed to say it was ready because I couldn't tell. So for the test, they made me sing and pointed the speakers away from me so that, and then they determined whether the pitch correction is good enough or not. So in March 2011, the day after Japan earthquake and resulting tsunami, a Glee user in Japan posted on Facebook asking people to join her. We posted her request in the app itself. What happened afterwards was beyond what we expected. Over 3,000 people joined in singing with her. It gives me the chills. It amazes me that over 3,000 people spent 2.5 minutes singing into their iPhones at the time. And what was even more amazing was that we were able to render all these voices together. We didn't test anything remotely close to this size, and it was truly magical because we didn't even know if it was going to work. And in fact, we had intense debates before Glee launched to limit big group songs because we were afraid that they would sound terrible. And we didn't build any special audio processing to handle group songs. In the end, the decision was that we simply do not know. We didn't know what the limit should be. We didn't know what the users would do. So we left it open to see what would happen, and this happened. So this is an eye-opening moment for me. I think it showed the magic is not only in what we build, but in what the users then can create on top of it with each other. And it's how we make magic with the users. So it's time to move on to the next stage. So at this point, we learned a lot about what's possible with audio and what engages users with audio apps. And over again, in every app, we see that beyond the core mechanic, the connections that people make with each other through the app is what keeps them coming back. Because it's not about the app, but it's in how the app helps them to do something else with someone else. So we needed to build a place, a playground, so that the users can come back, play, and explore what they're creating with each other, not just the app itself. So at the start of 2012, we took a deep breath and confronted the fact that we were falling short of our mission in a couple of ways. So in the first stage, we're focused on creating something engaging for our users. But that perspective, based on what we shared earlier, you could maybe say that the successful apps were ones that sounded, that were easy, accessible, fun to play, and that helped the user sound good. So you can see that where fiddle wasn't easy, and maybe the part of sounding good, because it was hard to also make the fiddle violin sound. Some people say it sounded like a theremin, some people, if you don't hit it just right, even though we're building all the vibrato, it was very hard. So that's all well and good, but what if we now looked at the axis through the lens of our mission and what we learned? Maybe connecting people and enabling them to be expressive matter more. And now if we rank the apps on this scale, it's clear that we were not doing enough to achieve our mission. Even though Magic Piano is super fun and one of my favorite apps, I once spent 45 minutes just playing one song over the rainbow at the airport. At the end of the day, it's not connecting people. And ultimately, it's still not as expressive enough to allow people to feel like that piano recording is their own creation. Magic Fiddle has similar limitations. Glee showed us what was possible when people connected with each other, and it was no longer about the app, but about something else. But we didn't build Glee to focus on the users and focus on their content. So we went back to the drawing board on social singing. We wanted to focus on enabling people to collaborate with each other and empower them to be creative. So here's a slide of an internal pitch deck, not shown ever publicly. So this is the cringeworthy part. You have to move fast. There were lots of creative ideas to make it more than just singing. Like we already built a singing app. So we wanted to build a mashup where you could build on singers and have a global group song every day and then maybe a singing game. So this first pitch failed our internal green light process. The feedback was that it's way too much and way too complicated. What was the core mechanic for the user? I'm sure you're all familiar with the concept of MVP, the minimal viable product. From experience, I could say it's one of the hardest things to make the cuts and absolutely the most critical. You want to build it all. And my only advice when you're confronted with choosing which features to cut is to remember that if you take up all your resources, time, and money building the one, then you may not have the runway to try again. And so we stripped it down. We realized that the essence is to capture the experience of singing, discovering people to sing with, and inviting them to sing with you. Singing and more singing with people is the core social engagement loop, and we better nail it. So if we were successful in doing that, then we could build all these other features upon it in the future. So in addition to building an app focused on social singing, we're also building a platform behind it to develop relationships between the users, the content that we create, and to facilitate the connections, the interactions between each of them. So, and this platform we build is agnostic to singing. It's simply about the user's content and how the content connects the users, regardless of how and where the content is created. So singing and the platform launching August 8th, 2012. Here's a clip from the marketing launch video so you can see some of the really earlier screenshots.
Every day I will remind you.
Those were screenshots that we won way before flat design. The app has gone through many iterations now, 5 years later. And you're probably wondering, okay, so what? We built another singing app. That's true, but that wasn't the only thing. What we realized is that we need to create a place for users to return. We had to think holistically about what the users are doing outside the app. What happens after they use the app? What happens to the content they recreate? They've just spent all this effort to sing in our song. Now what? It's to sing our app. Now what? And in order to become more than just an app in the user's mind, we had to build an end-to-end system where they can be invested in the content they've created and go beyond interacting with the app to interacting with their content and interacting with each other. So that's easier said than done. It turns out that when you build a place where people can get together and be creative, they don't do what you expect and want them to do. Group songs were terrible. This was part of our inspirations. What we feared came true. People were joining all over the place, and it was sounding terrible because anybody can join. Duets were fine because if one person ruined a duet, they didn't ruin all the other duets. But for group songs, one person can mess it up for everyone else. And we were considering having to add complicated group management controls where users can approve who joins first, but it would take up resources for other critical priorities. Or we were seriously considering killing the group feature, since there do not seem to be a good primary use case for group collaborations. And maybe the Glee Tsunami song was a fluke. Both were unappealing choices. This was a sad time, I remember. Then something amazing happened. Amazing group songs started appearing. Users were forming their own little sing groups, identifying with each other through usernames and profile photos. And here is a group performance between two different sing groups, and they called themselves sing families at the time. So it was with the Pride family, who are Filipino singers, and the Smulnesians. They were one of our first early sing communities, and they called themselves Smulnesians. It was extremely flattering. And at the time, I thought their marketing was better than ours, even. They had badges for everyone. They had like profile photos. Here it is.
Smulnesians and Pride family together.
In collaboration.
So that was our reaction, because this is the first we've seen of this kind of coordinated big group song, group collaborations of more than three or four people, where they were taking turns singing lines and joining each other. Certain two people was their lines, and not simply harmonizing through the whole song and singing together. And we're like, how are they doing this? How is this happening? And they had discovered a bug and repurposed it for the greater good. So we had put in a public-private feature in an update. And the intention at the time was to keep users recording private to themselves. Our users were asking that, you know, how do we make it private? However, we thought we had a bug, because if you wanted a feature, it only hid the recording from the user's public profiles and any public lists. So the users can still send a link to it or an invite to the private recording. And we actually had a top priority bug to fix this and secure it and lock it down. But it was going to take a lot of work, a lot of resources to secure the recording and add all the permission states as possible. So we really had privacy through obscurity. But in the meantime, the users discovered this bug, well, this feature, or this bug, and realized they could create a group recording, set it to private, invite only the people they want to join, and once they finish joining, they close the group invite, turn the recording public, and voila. They were communicating with each other through the comments. You can see in the comments how they were saying, hey, I've done my part, I'm done. So they were using the comments as a way to, communicate with each other. And then we also talked to them, found out that in addition, they had this other external communication where they're coordinating who sings which lines, who sings which parts, but they were coming in the app and doing this. So it was pretty clear how to fix the bug after we discovered this. We simply added a text label to explain what was happening and called it a day, scrapped our backlog. This is easily the most high impact, low scope feature I have ever built. And to this day, we still don't have the privacy concerns, and no user has ever complained about it. And so I know it may not seem like a big deal, but I love sharing this example because it demonstrates the lessons critical to this stage. When you're building a new community, a new system, someplace new for the users to play in, whatever it might be, it's important to not overbuild and focus on the basic features. Set the ground rules. Don't overthink it. We were overthinking it. We thought we had to add privacy permissions. We got to get group controls and management, add members, delete members. Let the users negotiate, shape what it means to them. And here's a complicated, here's a long quote explaining this in the context of building community that I really like. The gist is, don't be surprised if the users don't do what you expect. In fact, that is your goal. Strive to design and build something that's enabling enabling and implicit rather than prescriptive and explicit. Instead of imposing our rules of what we think a group would be, they were already doing it, and we just got out of their way. So that users have room to play and create the space that worked for them. And obviously, it's critical to not only be talking to the users during this time, you should be talking to users the whole time, but to observe what they're doing. Because they weren't telling us these things. They weren't exactly, you know, and we didn't know what questions to ask. And so we have to be observing and really just be in it with them. Especially at the start, when you want to work quickly to reinforce the behaviors that you want and squash the behaviors that you don't want. Now there are many, many groups in the community, all self-formed or organized. Here are just a few examples. 42nd Street, they're one of the original scene groups focused on musical theater. Dismantled Anatolians is a group of singers in Turkey. And The Voices is a group that's really great singers. So I want to just play for you a quick example for 42nd Street.
Darling, give me a head with hair, long beautiful hair, shining, gleaming, streaming, flaxen, waxing. Give me down to there, hair shoulder length or longer. Here, baby, there, mama, everywhere, daddy, daddy, hair. Flow it, show it, long as I can grow it, my hair.
They're really fun, they're really serious. In fact, they put in their comments directorial credit, so they have a user that directs them in like which parts of the scene they figured out how to do all the various parts. You can see that they're from all over the world, so they're not in the same location, and it's how they coordinated. And inevitably, then we hit the teenage years. It meant that we had to metaphorically let the users drive and let go of some control. There were two big decisions we made to get out of the user's way that I'd like to share with you. First of all, we added video. This is a controversial and a bit of a scary product decision. One of the biggest arguments against doing video at the time was that we were an audio company and had no business doing video. What do we know about video? And the other argument was simply that users wouldn't want to video themselves. If they're already shy about their voice, wouldn't they be even more shy about video? Both were very, very true, and both were very, very strong arguments. By the end of the day, there's no denying that music and video naturally go together. And I don't think we had any choice but to try our best. And so we started trying to design how we would do the video transition layouts. And initially, we were thinking that every song had a song form, which would then act like a video editor to splice together the user's videos at the proper transition sections in the song. Maybe there's an arc. When there's a high energy, we would move them a lot. However, we realized that's pretty difficult when you don't know anything about that video, and we couldn't possibly act like a video producer and analyze each video to determine the layouts of every recording, especially if you have multiple recordings of the same song. We also wanted each of them to be different. But if we imposed a rule, then all the recordings would be pretty boring because the transitions would look pretty alike. So this was a wrong approach. But realize we do know about audio, and in audio we trust. So audio is a critical part to video. In fact, audio can often change the tenor of a video. Based on that, our approach was to not even look at the video and first analyze the user's audio track to dictate the video layouts. In this way, the users are the users are actually the ones in control of how the videos appear based on their own audio, and they can unleash their creativity. So this is a visual rendering of the audio power, we call it audio power, for a group song, how it affects the video layouts and transitions. The reason it's called audio power is how loud the user is singing, and sometimes determines where they show in the layout, how often they appear in the layout. And our users figure it out. If they're quiet, then they wouldn't show up. So you see like the 40 seconds you're directing, they're specifically staying quiet. They know when to make a little bit of noise to show up. And then we apply the layouts at those stages. So we let the users decide when their video appears, how they want to do it, and now it's like open canvas for them. And this is, that's the video right now.
And the beauty of it all is when the sun comes shining through.
So you can see that your users aren't only singing, they're simply playing music together. Jazzology is another group, and they just record instruments backing for the users to sing with. So I'm glad we didn't decide for the users whether they want a video or not, and I'm glad that we didn't decide how video would look based on what we think the song's arc would be. I think the lesson here is the users will surprise you, and trust them, they will actually rise to the occasion in ways that you would not imagine, even stuff that we were scared of. Here's a second big decision for us to get out of the user's way. Some of you may have bins of records like this at home, I do. But this is not an example of how to organize your records. This illustrates that there are a lot of songs in the world. Apple Music reportedly has 40 million songs. Spotify has maybe 30 million songs, roughly. The number doesn't really matter, it's a lot. We had a music team arranging songs to put into the songbook every week, and after about 2 years, we had almost 2,000 songs in our songbook, mostly in English. It was clear we were limiting our users' creativity because we didn't have the songs that they want to sing, and that in turn limits our growth. So the only way to solve this in a scalable and sustainable way was to let go of our control of the songbook and let the users arrange the songs that they want to sing. And because this was a very specific task, where we needed a song in a specific structure format that worked with our backend, it was more complex, and we chose to do it on the web. We knew that this wasn't going to be something that was every user needed. In fact, probably just a very small percentage of users. And it was important to make sure that we gave users the ability to also attribute the songs under DMCA so that we could pay the artists and writers. The response from the users overwhelmingly validated that they've been just chomping at the bit for us to get out of their way so they could sing the songs for their own community. You can see the current top 10 countries arranging songs. And you know, our internal music team had arranged about 2,000 songs in almost 2 years. Our users are now arranging about 6,000 songs each day, providing the structured musical content that other Smule users perform. So this is truly now an end-to-end collaborative community because a user arranges a song that other users perform. So we were totally out of the loop now, and what we are doing is supporting them, building a platform to enable them, empower them. Because before, they had to sing the songs that we were arranging, so we were still dictating that. And now it's up to them. I think the impact to user engagement is fairly obvious. Here's a map of all the locations where users are uploading tracks. This is for 1 year in 2013, from when Sing first launched in August 2012 to about October 2013. We had a total of 10 million uploads in that first year. So I'm going to show you now the map of where everybody has uploaded just in the month of February alone this year. I don't know if you could tell. I'll go back a little bit. But here's a map showing all the uploads in February. And this is about 80 million uploads just in February this year. I think you can see the regions of growth were where we were seeing also regions of arrangement. You can see where Indonesia grew, India grew, Europe, Brazil, right there. It was very exciting. And those were countries that we probably weren't ever able to have our own music team arrange songs for them. And they were able to do this for themselves. So it's pretty mind-boggling to imagine all the music that people are engaging with and creating on Smule today. And we're in a virtuous feedback loop with our community. The more the users engage and create, the more they're inspiring us to build a better platform and experience for them to unleash their creativity. So the next stage is scale, and we're right in the throes of it right now. We store and track over 2 billion analytic events each day and growing, measuring how people engage in music all throughout the app. Here's a visual representation of Smule's social graph bound by region, language, and music preferences. So you can see this is through the content that they collaborate with and join with each other. So one thing that happens with growth is that obviously your data changes. And as our data changes with the growth of the community, then our AI and machine learning algorithms must be revisited because we didn't have those data to model before. Before our recommendation, we thought wasn't so bad when we had 2,000 songs. It's really not scalable now at this range. Actually, for example, one of our challenges is if you have, and this is one of the earlier complaints, and we had to add detection for your locale and region. Indonesia was blowing up. The users were arranging all these songs, and we had users come in and go, and they were being recommended. That was the most popular. That's what people were engaging in. They were like, but I don't speak Indonesian. And what's all? This is top in community. So then we had to put in a filter based on your location and your region. And now how do we learn that? But we still want some sieve to flow through, right? Because we don't want these to be pockets, not connected to each other. So how do you recommend content across that and make sure that people are still socially connected? So one of our active challenges now is how we keep up with the data and update our models as quickly as possible to deliver localized recommendations for users based on their country, their language, and their musical preference. And language is interesting, right? For example, Spanish is not limited to a specific country or zone. Actually, in the United States, the US, language is actually quite a big population, but we were just looking at countries only, and so in the US, we're only targeting English and missing out on the Spanish-speaking community. So, and then the next thing is, we have this community at scale, how do we leverage this community at scale and get deeper insights to improve the experience for everyone? So I don't have answers, and I'm almost out of time, and also, these are questions we're currently grappling with. I'm not sure if we're in the teenage phase now or we're now in the adult phase. To be honest, adulting is hard, and you have to remember all the lessons you've learned earlier, so maybe my analogy is breaking down a little bit here, but perhaps topic for another time. So to summarize the lessons so far, engage the user first by enabling them to do something they couldn't do before in a magically accessible way. Focus on what the users can do. You may have solved the hardest technical problem like Magic Fiddle, but it won't matter if the users aren't engaged. Once engaged, find a way for users to play together and so that they could push against the boundaries, so that they can explore what to do. It's like when you're playing on a playground. And find a way for them to engage with other users, and together they could discover what it is they really want to do. And be prepared that they may not do what you want them to do and not expect at all. That could be a beautiful gift at this stage and help set the direction for the next stage of growth. And then at some point, to reach the next level of growth, you have to let go of control and let the users drive. Re-examine your assumptions and figure out where your product might be dictating a certain behavior and limiting the user's creativity. One thing to note here is that also means letting go of the quality of standards. For example, we know that all 2,000 songs that Smule arranged and put in a songbook are good quality. It had good lyrics, it had good timing. But not all the 6,000 songs added today will be good quality and singable. And so we found a different way to determine quality by letting the users rate themselves. The lesson here is have faith in your users and don't impose your standards for music on them. They will determine that. And every step of the way, the number one thing to remember is to focus on your users and building a growing, lasting relationship with them. Here's a video mix of our users using Smule.
Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. 'Cause the trouble, it might drag you down. If you get lost, you can always be found. Just know you're not alone. 'Cause I'm gonna make this place your home.
I've never expected an app to, you know, bring such different people together.
Smule is inspiration.
Smule is opportunity.
Smule is life.
Smule is happiness.
So we didn't pay any of those people. So they set up on their own. I believe that innovations in audio technology is a critical component enabling and empowering people to be creative, expressive, and connected. None of Smule would have happened without the audio technology. So I hope that some of my lessons learned here will help you navigate your own products and services, and I'd love to hear about yours. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jeannie, for that amazing journey. Really cool. So does anyone have a few questions for her? Question at the back there? Furthest person away from the microphone, sorry.
I'm sorry. A current that was underneath a lot of what you spoke about is learning. With the magic fiddle, for example, it was too difficult. Maybe with the magic piano, it was too easy. A lot of us here make very, very complicated tools for professionals, but those are hard to learn too, and professionals need to learn as well. Do you have any strategies for encouraging learning or supporting learning?
That's a really, I think when you're building a product and service, learning, actually the biggest strategy is to talk to your users all the time, constantly, however you can. And actually spy on them, observe them, stalk them, which is in the early days, what we did, actually most of my Facebook connections are actually from people in the early days of seeing. So I think there's no silver bullet. You have to just be in it with them as well. It's not you're doing something for them and it's over the wall. Here are their frustrations and actually just find out what they're doing.
Any more questions? Who's first? Maybe down the front here. The mic's gone over that way.
Yeah. Thanks for the great talk. Some impressive numbers, really. I would, if it's not too much to ask, I would be interested in how the monetization works. So what's the primary or the top three ways, for example, for that to monetize?
Yeah, so in Smule, we have tried every single monetization method that, through the mobile ecosystem currently, but I think the thing that really made sense for us was subscriptions, was using subscriptions. So you saw the revenue numbers, and that's all from the subscription revenue and actually growing the subscribers, because for us, it's building the long-term relationship with the user, and with a subscription, once you get them, it's really about how do you retain them? How do you keep a better experience so they don't churn out? So I think it really you have to really look at your product and your service and what makes sense and sort of what kind of engagement and retention you want to drive with it and what happens. And I think as we go, as we look further and beyond, though, we are now exploring how do we actually now open up even further and look at advertising in a different way. So, but I think it really depends on your product and service and what you want to, what kind of relationship you want to have with your user.
We had a question at the front here.
Yeah, thanks for a really inspiring talk. It's a really great way to end the evening. I think you touched on it briefly about when you opened the songbook up, how did you get around, or how did you pay publishing or sort that out with copyrighted content?
Yeah, we actually have relationships and work with over 300 publishers. And so we track every time the user streams a song, we actually track down, we pay out the publisher royalty. So yeah, we that's actually one of the things that we did from the very, very beginning. And so we have a VP part of artists, and we work with licensing with all the publishers.
Does that mean you sometimes have to veto something when they submit
it? Yes, so they will give us their blacklist or various, but the community arrangements is based on CCCP, based on DMCA, CCC Fuse, our code name, internal code name for it. I won't tell you what it stands for. sorry, so that just came out because we say it so much. And well, I will tell you because I'm kind of upset that became the code name. I asked my product manager to say, okay, guys, you got to figure out a code name for community content production. And he's like a smart ass came back with, how about CCCP, code name for community content production? I was like, so, but it's based on DMCA. So, but what we do is also when, if you go on the website, you'll see when the users put in their song title, we drop down all the songs that we already have licenses for. So they could select it and they're arranging a song for it, and then we directly attribute it. And then we honor takedown notices. And so when they take down notice, we ask them if they want us to take it down, in which case we'll take it down and then all the songs and recordings will be gone. Or if they want us to start paying them loyalty. So, which would be great.
Okay, question at the back there. Keeping Sophie running up and down here.
Hi, I'm just curious whether your users have expressed the desire to add to the songbook actual original compositions of theirs.
Oh, they're already doing it.
Okay.
They don't even have to ask us because they could do it. In fact,
okay.
Most of them, one of the earlier guitars, he actually just even uploads his own guitar arrangements of certain songs, so you don't have to just sing to the karaoke tracks or various tracks. People, they're doing their own arrangements of songs. They're doing their own original songs and asking the community to sing with them. And one of the things we're looking at is how do we help promote the emerging artists? How do we help their songs get discovered?
Any more? One over here.
It's great to see how Smule has grown over the years. What kind of things did you have to do to spark the community? Did you have to do some sort of singer recognition and kind of things to get people involved with this to take it to the next level, or was it completely organically done?
So that's a great question. We already had Smule already has a base, well known, and we had the Glee karaoke, so a lot of those users went over to sing karaoke. So we also do, when you say spark, do you mean like how to engage with the product, or how do we acquire new users?
How do the users get the sense of accomplishment with the app? So, you know, the sense that I have created something fantastic and I can show this to other people.
You know, I will be honest. I don't think we're doing a very good job still of it. And I think the one thing that we did is after you sing, you have the karaoke score at the end. And that was our way of just saying, as a sort of a easy way to say, here's a score and a great job. What it was, and that's essentially it. At the end of the day, I think it's how they connect with people. I actually have a funny story about that scoring, which I didn't add to the talk, is in that we had so the score just shows up at the end, and for us, we're always like, we're not doing the best job on this audio score. If you harmonize, you're not singing along the main melody line, we don't know how to score you. If they're joining with each other, so, you know, sometimes they don't sing certain parts, so their score is not as high. So it's really not that meaningful. How do we do a better job? And we were just like, barrier, you know, other problems. And so we released an update, and we saw our engagement retention just start to plummet. And we didn't know what was going on. We dug everywhere. And then we found we had an audio bug that, regardless of what you did, a percentage of users, when they got to the end of their singing, the score was zero, and whether you made noise or not. And you know, we didn't think that was, you know, we were like, it's a score, no one cares about the score, it didn't mean anything, right? But it turns out that was a lose-lose situation. What happened, which seems obvious now, you guys are all, of course, but at the time, we had dug everywhere to find out what was wrong. The good singers, we're like, your app sucks. There's no way I could have scored a zero. I'm great. They're not going to come back. The bad singer, which is majority, we've reinforced their belief that they're not a good singer. They're like, yeah, zero. And they didn't come back. So we had a lose-lose situation. And so kind of made a call. I was like, I don't care if they make any noise. You just double and triple and whatever, quadruple that score. You make that thing a high number. So I don't think that's the best answer. I think it's something we're figuring out. I think focusing on connecting them with users actually is the most important thing. What we found that so I'll get serious. The most important thing is closing that social loop. If you sing us, if you join someone and you get a love, that was like incredible. If I join Julian and Julian loved it, oh my gosh. If I join Julian and Julian commented on it, now I'm in. So it's, but for Julian, he's like, oh, I got someone to join, my loop is closed. So it's how do you get this loop to be continuously, and that's actually the social loop that, that validates the most.
Great, let's have one more question. Someone at the far, far back there.
Hi. Just a quick question about the independent artists that are uploading their own material. Is there a system in place or plans for a system where they would be able to get compensated for any sort of streaming if they were able to get any sort of movement?
Yeah, we love to do that. We don't have that in place right now.
Cool, thanks.
Great. Well, we'll call this a day there. Don't all go home. We've still got stuff going on in this room. We've got the Juice Awards later. We're going to have pizza downstairs at 6:30, is that right? Or now? Oh, 7. Pizza downstairs at 7. The bar will be open. It'll be pay bar, but it'll be open downstairs. And then the Juice Awards. And, yeah, so stick around for that. It's going to be great. And one last big hand for Jeannie.